is the story of a lost neighborhood and of its people who did not want to go.
I don't want no money. I want my home. The old man is old. Yeah, the old man is old. No more. That's enough. I don't want to get out. I said to my two daughters, they don't want to get out because they spend a lot of money. Plenty of money they spend in this place. We not get nice to nobody. Never.
Hi. Welcome to the West End Video Newsletter. Tonight we're going to do a little something. We're going to travel back in time. When we first started the newsletter and the West End Video Newsletter, the TV show here that you're watching, we started all this and we had our first reunion, and most people hadn't seen each other in the West End for approximately 30 years or so, and we had a reunion that had like close to 2,000 people up in Wonderland Ballroom, and we really had a good time. And I'd like to go back to those days. Some of these people are deceased now. They've died in the meantime. But it was great that we captured it on film. We would like to show you this and bring you a little bit of what happened that night. It was a little bit of magic because it was the first time in many, many years that we'd ever gotten together again. And I'd like to share this with you. And maybe in another so many years we'll run it again. But we're going back to November 15th, 1986. And we will show you our first reunion, and that's when all this got started. Since then, we've had many more, and we've done quite a few things. We've gone on to bigger and better things. But roll tape, Joe.
Thank you. she's walking.
My name is George Lanigan. I had the honor of representing the West End of Boston in the state legislature from 1941 to 1948. And I also represented the West End in the Boston City Council from 1947 to 1951. I'm eternally grateful for the friendships that I created while a West Ender. And once a West Ender, always a West Ender.
You expected your neighbor to help you, and it was no big thing. And then when it was torn down, I'm quite sure that a lot of people, when they moved to Beer, and not saying that love isn't in the suburbs, don't get me wrong, there are wonderful people everywhere, but we always felt that we had cornered the market on great people, yeah. And it was just the friendship, I guess. The help. When you look at, all you have to do is flash that camera around and see the people. It's wonderful. Friendship, love, and being honest. Honest people, honest. I wish I could explain it, you know, without.
Can I give a kiss on the camera?
That's my buddy, Joe.
Love, friendship.
My old buddy.
Tell me a little bit about, what was a Saturday morning like in your neighborhood?
Punch ball. Now, do you know what punch ball is? You had the pimple ball, you see? So, and you played it according to the rules of baseball. You threw the ball up there, you punched it, and you ran the bases, and if it caught it, you're out, and you had to do this, force out the rules of baseball. But it was always in the schoolyards on the cement. You'd slide on the cement. Because you'd ruined the pants, but it didn't bother you because it was your brother's pants that you put on that morning at 7 o'clock.
West End until?
Until I was 16 years old. And my best recollection of it was the Peabody House dances on Friday night and then going to Andy's Pizzeria for a pizza for 35 cents. And listening to the jukebox.
A quarter. My name is Barbara Filato. I left there when I was 15. It's the first time I've seen these girls in 30 years. They look marvelous.
Does it make you feel that the West End is still alive?
Oh, I guess so. Look at this. Yes.
See? I lived there until I think it was 55, 56, 57. I don't know. I'm getting senile anyway. But did I give you my name? Okay, now what do you want to know?
Tell me a little bit about some of these people standing around you. When was the last time you saw them?
Maybe 25 years ago, 30 years ago, 10 minutes ago, a half hour ago. I don't know. Get her. She talks.
Hey. Just identify yourself for the camera here and tell us when you lived in the West End.
I'm Lorraine Lanzillo. Book and school, Joe DeGreese's, the pinball machines, swimming in the channel. Sure.
Where is that? What is there today?
The channel.
Still there.
Cookie Sarrow, I remember Elizabeth Peabody House and all the things we used to do. Everything.
Give me a couple of specifics.
Breaking windows and among a lot of other things I don't even want to say.
Destroying bathrooms.
We had the great West End pool. We had great fun there. Sneaking in the Lancaster Theater.
What was that?
That's at the North Station, Boston. It's the Pussycat now. Buying loose cigarettes, three for a nickel. My name is Bootsy.
When you look around here today, what does it make you feel like? Does it bring back all sorts of good emotions?
Yes, I think of when I was young and the Peabody House and the Friday night dances and the Andy's Pizzeria. So many things.
We all still would have been living there, believe me.
Right.
That's right.
Down, we'd probably still be there.
I loved it there.
Right.
I think
everybody cared about each other then. Today, people are into, you know, more into themselves. You know, if your mother wasn't home, you can go right next door to the people next door and they'd feed you.
Would you say then that there was a feeling of neighborhood there that you've never
seen? Definitely, definitely.
We had no racial discrimination. There was Polacks, Jewish, Italians, I'm French. There was a mixture of everything. It was
and everybody
different.
Got along then, I think. People cared about each other.
Have you stayed in touch with people who were your neighbors through the years?
A few, yeah.
But this is certainly helping you to bring them back together.
Oh, yeah. And we get the West End letter 4 times a year, and it, you know, keeps us in touch.
And if you had a chance, perhaps, to move back to the West End, if there were new developments there, would you do it?
At times, yes.
I would.
It's really people, like right now, my kids just bought a house and I'm living in it. But at the time, before that, I would have moved back in a minute. But I don't know what will happen next year. If my kids don't have the house, I'd go there, definitely. I would have never moved from there.
And how about just a couple of memories of school there? Where did you go to school in West End?
Blackstone School, Peter Manuel.
St. Joseph's School as well.
Father Powell, on Monday, used to come to church and to school to make sure we went to church.
All good memories.
We walked the town, walked everywhere.
We leave our doors open 24 hours a day. We weren't afraid of anything. We fought the rats and we fought the cracker roaches.
Right.
Doors were always open.
We could run home at 2 o'clock in the morning with nothing on and nobody would bother us.
We were never afraid of nobody.
Okay, Jim Campano and John Moore.
Right.
Tell me a little bit about how this whole reunion came about.
Well, we originally started through the newsletter, and then we slowly, as it evolved, one of my friends, Sonny Lopresti, went to a reunion. He said, that's a great idea. It was in Rosendale. And he said, with street signs all over the place. He says, let's have it. So I said, fine, we'll do it. I'll put it in the newsletter and see what happens. And the response was overwhelming. As you can see, the place is loaded.
Seeing a lot of familiar faces around?
A lot of familiar faces. I've seen a lot of people I've seen since I was a baby, and I love it. And everybody's just good people. This is it.
It's more of a gathering of the clan,
okay? Right.
And probably
this is what
anything
a neighborhood
else.
Is all about.
Yeah.
Does it make you feel that the whole concept of neighborhood really just doesn't exist anymore?
Well, in my neighborhood where I live, in Dorchester and Mattapan, we're trying to do the same thing with different things and different organizations are getting together just to get together to be a social, just like this.
I mean, it probably exists in other neighborhoods, but not to the depth, okay? This is 30 years after the fact. Okay, you're talking about an outpouring of feeling that nobody realized was there, okay? The West End was a cohesive neighborhood that is impossible to reconstruct, okay? And the rest of the city let us down when they let the city in and just rip it down wholesale. Okay, now there are certain sociologists that did sociology studies like Gans and Jacobs who wrote about the neighborhoods, and they tell you exactly what happened. Now the lie was out that everybody wanted to leave, okay? In other words, we rode out on cockroaches, you know, we were happy, you know, to get out. But that wasn't the truth. It was a big lie, right.
So given the possibility of a chance to return, you would do it?
Sure. With the same people. I mean, if I had to live with Rappaport and those people, I'd shoot myself.
No.
Same people, okay? That's all I qualified at.
Now, I'm going to throw a couple of names at you, and I just want you to let it flow. Let me tell you, whatever comes to your mind, we want to hear it, okay? Let's go street by street in there. I want to hear what you have to say. How about Spring Street? What do you remember about Spring Street?
Bustling commercial avenue, okay? There was all types of businesses on it. You could go down there with the push carts. It was like the market area, but only on a very small scale, okay? It was kosher chicken stores and fruit markets and, you know, vegetable markets. It was just a great place. You could go down there and get anything from there was archery's hosiery to just about anything you wanted. It was a very viable neighborhood, and they ruined it. That's about all I can say.
He knows it all. He knows it all.
How about Leverett Street? Did you spend any time there?
I was a baby.
Leverett Street was a little different, okay? Leverett Street was more of a commercial street, a lot of furniture. I'm talking about big furniture outlets, you know, not little furniture stores, but old warehouses, a lot of bar rooms. It was more like it was a bigger thoroughfare, and it was just a little bit more, it was a little different type clientele and atmosphere.
Now, John, you say you were very, very young when you left the West End, when the West End was destroyed. How come you think it is that you have such strong feelings for it still?
Because of the friends I had, because of the clubhouse, because of the neighborhood, the cohesiveness, and the friends that my father, my brother, my sister, my mother all made. They still know me. And I've met a lot of other people who have been, in terms of where I've been, in terms of work, that I've met people who still remember me and my family, in terms of different colors of people. Jews, Italians, Polacks, whatever, they still remember me.
And as, again, you look around the reunion room right now, does it give you a sense of pride having put so much time and effort into it?
More than a sense of pride, it gives me a feeling in the heart that I couldn't get anywhere else, okay? The Globe did an article on us about a week ago, okay? And a lot of the people that called me up over that article, one of the first things they say, and it seemed to be most of the people that I've talked to have said, it made me cry, okay? So that's the type of feeling that we're talking about here. We're not talking about just someone saying, well, gee, it was nice when I was a kid. You know, we're talking about the depth of feelings, sad feelings. I would say this, you know how close South Boston is supposed to be, okay? That's supposed to be like tight. The West End was probably 50 times as tight, okay? It was just, you can't believe it, okay? There is a story. There was a West End guy that was in Korea. He won the Silver Star when the communists came over and ran everybody back. Him and two other guys held off a battalion of communist troops. When I seen him, I was talking to him in a bar. He said, you won't believe. I said, why didn't you run? He says, you won't believe it. And I asked him, I said, what do you mean? Tell me. He said, if I went home, the guys would laugh at me. Now, if you're facing a whole battalion of communists shooting at you, and you don't want to run because you're afraid to go home because they'll laugh at you, I think that's strong. That is strong emotions, okay? So,
one more question for you, Jimmy. Do you have children?
Sure.
What do they know about the West End? What do they feel about it?
Not a hell of a lot. Okay, most of the people that have kids, everybody says, I don't want to listen to those stories no more. That's why. That's one of the reasons the newsletter was formed. The reason why the newsletter was formed was because everybody tells these stories, these West End stories, over and over and over again. This way, they put it down once and it's over. Okay? There's a million favorite West End stories. Everybody has them, and that's why it goes into the newsletter and gets filed, and then the story's over. It's finished.
Gonna be back for a reunion next year, you think, John?
Definitely, definitely. This is a family. This is our family, and I mean that. Family.
Go ahead, Marie.
Okay, Lovey, do you remember the night that you were kidnapped from the Peabody Playhouse?
Oh, come on.
Come on, why were you?
I don't know why, I forget.
You had a fist fight in the ladies' room.
No, not me.
They kidnapped her to get her away.
Not me. I was a perfect lady.
Never.
The West End
Never.
Was the best town.
Who's a stand of line? These women have great hickeys.
Unbelievable.
The best hickeys in the world.
Oh, that's nasty.
Well, you've seen a little bit of that time. It was a long time, like I say, a long time ago. There were some people there that were talking about the West End. They were coming from their hearts, and because they hadn't seen each other for a long time, like I said, and especially like Roger Jackman, who was funny, Tony Odo, who was very glib. He's a very good speaker, and he was talking from his heart. And John Moore. John Moore was a close friend of mine. John Moore unfortunately died about 10 months ago. He was a great guy, and I really, I'm glad you can see a little bit of him. Anyways, and I guess that's about it. Let's go back and see the rest of it, dude. Roll tape.
We're holding up.
Doesn't matter.
We all have that.
They've never done this to us.
No.
Well,
you know?
There'll always be a West End, though, even though it's not
and
on the ground. It'll
every
still
one
be
of
there.
Us have that empty feeling. Yeah. We can't bring our kids or grandchildren to show them where we were brought up. You know?
And I can't take him to the corner. I can't show him where I went to school. But he snuck in here tonight. Because you know why? He wanted to see why I was so excited. And you know what? He's overwhelmed because he can't believe what's going on here tonight. The people.
And do you have a feel now for what the West End was?
It's like a trip through the past. It really is.
Really?
Were you born there?
No, my mother was.
No. I was single. I was 15 years old when they tore it down.
My mother just moved off. You know where the new federal building is? North Station? That was my street, Billerica Street. They threw her out 7 years ago. And that was the end of our past. It was gone.
She was the last one to move out.
Yeah, I was Bobby's one of
it had to be great or we all wouldn't be here tonight. And it'll go on and on
every
and
nationality,
on.
I mean.
Now tell me, where did you live when you lived in the West End?
Russell Street. The sign, if you lived here now, you'd be home Willard Street.
Yeah.
Willard, 16 Willard Street, and I had a Polish landlord, and you had to scrub the stairs every Saturday. Every Saturday. I should tell you what, the rent was $16
a month. I was on Leverett Street and Billerica Street. And I was born on Lowell Street. I was born.
Oh, tonight is such a wonderful feeling. This is like the West End coming alive again. My mother's from the West End. My wife was born there. As a matter of fact, I'll let you in a little secret. The first 10 months of my life, I lived in the West End myself. So I have a really warm feeling. There's a lot of people here that I know and I haven't seen in many years. It's really gratifying to see so many here tonight.
I would not want to take my son back to a high-rise apartment and say, Nicholas, this is where I was born. I would like to recoup what we initially lost 30 years ago by the BRA short-sightedness and Jerome Rappaport's financial investment. I would like to take my son back to a place to say, this is where I was born. This is my museum, and this is where I live.
You say the neighborhood still exists?
It does to this day. Yes, it does.
And you plan more events like this in the future?
Hopefully, yes, we do.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
I just wanted to say that you're seeing part of a love affair that's gone on for a number of years. It's a love affair between a neighborhood and the people that live there. And they're here tonight to get a small piece of the dream. They had a dream that was promised to them that they were deprived of many years ago when the neighborhood was taken away from them. They were promised that they would come back, and they could never come back, and this is the closest that we could come to it. And we're so grateful to be here and have a few moments to be together because, after all, the neighborhood really is the people that lived in the neighborhood. And we love each other, and we're so grateful to have a moment together.
Yours is a name that has cropped up a couple of times in the West Ender newsletter. Why don't you tell me a little bit about that?
Well, I do a little bit of writing, and I've written 170 pages so far about a story about the West End, and it has to be fictional because I have to do some name-calling for some certain politicians, but as soon as I get done, someone call me up and publish it, will you?
Now, John Hoke, you're a little bit unique around here because you still live in the West End.
Yes, I'm the last of the West Enders. I still live at 42 Lemazenby Way. And this is a great showing of the people who were all brought up together. All different nationalities, all different religions, and we're all, look at it, everybody loves one another. And that's the way it was for 30 years, 40 years. I'm a third generation West Ender. West End House, Peabody House, all of it. The softball league, everything. St. Joseph's School, Blackstone School. It was just one great big happy family.
Tell me a little bit about your memories of those school buildings.
school while I went to St. Joseph's, which was a little stricter. And the nuns were very, very good. He came out with a little knowledge anyway. He could count 2 and 2 is 4 when he got out of St. Joe's. The Blackstone School, a little, you know, the hammer and nail school. But all them guys, they all become successful. And what more can I say? They all became successful. There's not one that didn't.
Were you living in the West End until it was gone?
Yeah, up until 1958. We lived on Ashland Street.
And as you drive through that area right now, how does it make you feel?
Well, when I drive by and I see, if you lived here now, you'd be home. Gets me mad.
It's one big neighborhood, even though a lot of the people come from the North End and the West End. I used to coach in the West End house, and I used to coach at the Peabody House, which was in the West End. So it's a big feeling here, one big family.
I love everybody from the West End.
She was in this class, and I was in this class.
Yeah, it's really funny. Yeah, this is junior high.
Did you bring this in just for tonight?
Sure. Boy, look, I dug it out. It's well worn.
You won't part with it. And I said, I don't blame you, Scherner. I wouldn't part with it either.
There was a feeling there that you can't explain. I'm sure you heard this story before. You just can't explain that feeling that was there. You just can't.
The biggest thing about the West End was the friendship. The friendship, the bond of friendship. Unbelievable. Unbelievable. See these people again. Everybody loves everybody. That's what it was. Oh, we had our rough times, you know. You could leave doors open. The summer you open the door to get a draft, you know, to get a little draft. We didn't have air conditioning in those days. And it was just, you know, a friendship. You didn't have to worry about someone walking in, robbing your place and everything. You know, society has changed, as you well know, you know. This was the greatest iceman in the old days. Joe D'Amato.
The greatest iceman?
He was my iceman. We didn't have refrigerators. Now you're bringing up memories now.
Glad to be here.
Well, that was the reunion we had back in 1986. It was the start of most of the stuff that we did. We had just started the newsletter, and we just started the TV show. We've gone on to bigger and better things since then. It was a magical night, and everybody had a great time, and it was a time that we hadn't seen each other for a long time, so it really worked out well. We were quite happy with it. We've had other reunions since, but we haven't had one for about 5 years. There's some talk now that they're going to reinstitute it and do another one sometime in the coming year, and it'll be a good time. We've always had good times. Unfortunately, that was 12 years ago, and a lot of those people have died, and so we probably won't have the crowds of 2,000 or so that we used to have, but enough of that morbid stuff, and I'll see you at the next West End Video Newsletter.